And if you don't give a shit, then you're fucked. You have to understand you are out here alone, absolutely alone. And when you understand these three things, you start to see how a mindset comes together. Nobody's gonna save you. You're fucked. It's totally down to you. You're pissed off with your current situation and you wanna change it. Plus, you believe you can do absolutely anything. This is how I thought at 18 years old. This is how I achieved so much in the short years. This is how I went from a nobody to a world-level athlete and a multimillionaire. Because at a very young age, when I had my prime resource of energy and power at 18, 19 years old, I understood those three tenets. I believe I can do anything. I'm pissed off I don't have the life I want. And nobody else is gonna give it to me. These are three things you need to understand. If any one of these elements is missing, you'll never have the right mindset. The G mindset will never formulate if any one of these elements is missing. All three are absolutely essential. And the sooner you get your act together, the sooner you start to panic and worry and be concerned that you're 24, 25, you're not fucking rich yet. There's 24 and 25 year olds out there who are multimillionaires fucking the hot models. These Instagram girls with 3 million followers, they're getting dicked by someone and it ain't you. And that needs to piss you off. You need to get concerned, you get worried, you need, shit, I'm running out of time. You need to get some urgency in your life. So I became a sayer. So my brother said, you've become a sayer. And what that means is I made a pact to him that my word was unbreakable, strength and honor. And that if I said something, I meant it. So I'd wake up in the morning and I'd say to my brother, I'm doing 1,000 press-ups today. Once I said it, once I spoke it, it's like a genie, it became true. If I said I was gonna do 1,000 press-ups, I'd do them. Because if I didn't do them, I'd feel guilty within myself that I was the kind of person who talks shit. Because when you instill these mindsets, when your mindset changes, you start to be extremely accountable for yourself. No one's coming to save you. You become extremely accountable. So when you realize that your word is one of the few things you have on this planet, if you say things, you're gonna start sticking to them. So then it becomes very easy to train. You say, I'm gonna train every day this week. I'm gonna train for 2 hours a day. As soon as you set it, it's basically done. If I say something, it is basically done. It's set in stone. And this is another thing you need to understand with the G mindset. You have to be very, very specific with what you say. Because if you instill your mindset correctly and you start to just say things, just start saying things. Then you hold yourself accountable. Say things you don't even think you want to do. Wake up and go up to your friend or your mom or whoever and say, you know what? I'm going to do 1,000 push-ups today. Say it to people. And they're going to say, no, you're not. So watch me. And then you have a choice. You're either going to succeed like a G or you're going to be a little pussy. And you're going to quit at 310 because it's hard. What kind of man are you? That's a decision you need to make. This is another facet of the G mindset. And your word has to be iron, unbreakable. You have to start meaning every word you speak. You say to someone, I'm gonna get rich. You better fucking do it. Otherwise, you're a liar. You're a liar and you're a little bitch. You say, I'm gonna put some muscle on, you better fucking do it. You say, I'm gonna lift this weight, you better fucking do it. You say, I'm gonna go get this girl, you better go get her. You gotta be the kind of person who says things and means them. You promise a guy you're gonna whoop his ass, you better whoop his ass. 99% of the people out here talk shit. They say things they half mean or things they don't mean. If I say something, I fucking mean it. Once you implement that correctly, then you get the ability to motivate yourself to no end. You get unlimited motivation because all you have to do is find the energy to say it. It's literally that easy. This is the fourth tenet and one of the most important ones because that is the power to unlimited motivation. And that's the power to be taken seriously across all spheres of your life. Be specific with your language. Sound like simple things, but to implement them correctly, truly and correctly, in your mind will change your entire view of the world. When you implement these four things correctly, when you say, if I say something, I'm gonna do it, my word is iron-willed. When you say that nobody is ever coming to save me, ever. When you say that I'm pissed off, I don't have the life I want to have. And you couple that with, I believe I can do anything. If you truly believe all of these four things, it's gonna change your entire view of this planet. When my most famous tweet is when I said depression wasn't real. I was having arguments with all these people. And everyone's telling me how dangerous my mindset is. What is dangerous about believing that you control your own mind? Because if you implement the four things I've just told you, depression becomes garbage. Depression's not a thing anymore. Feeling depressed is real. You can be depressed with your situation, but believing you can fix it yourself is the important key. Sitting there believing that depression is some monster from the sky that strikes your brain and now you have no control over it and you must take pills every day is the absolute enemy to a G mindset. I don't give a fuck how depressing my situation. The only person who can change it is me. The only person who can change how I feel about my situation or try and affect the situation directly is me. Even if you put me in a situation I can't change, if you put me in jail and I'm depressed because I'm in jail, I still refuse to succumb to depression. I refuse to collapse mentally and give up. I know the only person who can control my mind is me. Nobody's coming to save me. No doctor with a pill is coming to save me. Depression isn't real. Depression is a state of mind designed to motivate you to find a life that doesn't depress you any further. That's all it is. Now you have to decide, are you man enough to go and get it done, or are you gonna sit around and cry? And depression in the Western world is the cure-all. It's the cure-all excuse. This is what people are using. My life's shit because I'm depressed. No, you're depressed because your life is shit. It's the other way around, and you're refusing to acknowledge that, and you wanna sit there and live a shit life and pretend that some disease has struck you. And the reason you know that's bullshit, anyone out there who's depressed, I'll tell you something, you're not depressed, you're a coward. And the reason you're a coward is as follows. You desperately try to defend this crippling ailment you have because you're desperate to defend your excuse. If depression was really terrible, you wouldn't want to defend it. If depression was really so bad, and I'm telling you it's not real, and I know how to fix you, and if you implement a mindset like mine, you become immune to depression. If depression was so terrible, you'd listen to me and think, I need to try what this guy does. But instead, no. You don't want to do that. You want to call me names and sit and defend this ailment because you know it's garbage. It's your excuse. It's your blanket. It's your shield. It's your excuse you get to pull out every time you look at your failure of a life. And that's why depression is absolutely and utterly not real. Drop that coward bullshit. If you're watching this and you're depressed, drop and give me 200 press-ups. Look in the mirror, look in your eyes and tell yourself you're the fucking man and drop that garbage because you can get absolutely nowhere in your life if you believe in that crap. Depression absolutely isn't real. Implement the four things I've told you, the four important tenets of a G mindset. Understand nobody's coming to save you. Depression isn't real. You'll change your entire worldview once these four things are implemented correctly, and then we can move on to everything.
Ain't worried about you niggas hating on me. You ain't got nothing better to do with your time. I don't chill watching my every move. Trying to watch everything I do. Ain't worried about you niggas. No, I ain't worried about you niggas. I'm getting mine. Just out there. Ain't worried about you niggas hating on me. Nah. You ain't got nothing better to do with your time.
Apple make, the ones they use to like modify Hollywood movies, cost $75,000 each.
You know, remember when I did that?
Yep. Oh.
That's not working. Oh, the police took our computers. Duh. And all our phones. And our iPads. And our laptops. It's fine. Let's go to the emergency room. Let's talk about the emergency room. Let's talk about what the fact that the police came to me, the top G, triggered on, and apologized. We're sorry. First words they said to me were sorry. People online are like, why didn't they rough you up? Why didn't they tackle you to the ground? Because you don't understand respect. The police know me. They didn't want to come here. They're like, bro, sorry, G. We know you're the top G, but we have to. Right now, in fucking Belarus somewhere, top level Ukrainians and top level Russians are sitting talking very cordial. They're like politely smiling, shaking hands. The peasants at the bottom are getting roughed up and blown up, right? But at the top, people are always friends, even if they're on enemy sides. You don't understand. The generals in war have always been friends. World War II, when the Russians generals sat down with the German generals to negotiate surrender, they all had dinner. So if you're like, oh, the police come in and rough me up, because you're a low-level peasant. When the police come into my house, they wipe their shoes and they apologize. They took my computers, unfortunately. Sorry, top G, had to take your computers. It's fine. Doesn't matter. I'm innocent anyway, as we all fucking know. Man of God. Dude, emergency meeting. Luke's first ever appearance on emergency.
Maximum critical damage. I will take your life. I'm the producer, bro. I'm one of God's favorites. I exist as a beacon of light in a dark world.
Ready? True. I think it's my first time in here.
Gentlemen.
Hello.
Thanks. Hello.
This is literally my first time in here.
It's your first one ever.
I've never ever been in here.
You've never been here?
No, never.
Ah, the police took the emergency meeting computer. They took all the cameras.
Ah.
Christina won't have anything to steady moving. Steady cam's moving. But Scott Adams' wife, steady with the camera. Ex-wife. Sorry, she jumped. I said to her, you've done so well. A nice steady hand job. If she gets upset and doesn't do her job, I can switch it to steady. That power. From the police. Scott Adams' wife. Disappointing. So I think I want to clear a few things up because there's some bullshit on the internet about why the police raided my house. So I'm going to clear it up with an official statement here from the Gutted Out Emergency Meeting podcast. Basically, what happened is stupid, as we all know. Am I allowed to say that on YouTube? Well, it's fucking true. Some whoopee was chilling with tea. They made love. And then Tristan stopped replying to her texts. Why? Because it's Tristan fucking Taylor. So he stopped replying. Thought, fuck her. She's from, I don't know where she's from. Some other country. I don't know where she's from. She's not Romanian. And after they slept together, he ignored her one day. Hey, let's go out for dinner. Ignored her. Kept ignoring her. Then turns out she has a boyfriend. So the boyfriend found out she was with Tristan. So now she's in a hard situation, right? Because she doesn't want to admit to her boyfriend she's been cheating with the guy who now ignores her completely. So she says, oh, yeah, but I was with him, but I didn't want to be. I was at their house and I couldn't leave. Like she was kidnapped. Even though all of our CCTV, which the police now have, prove that she came by Uber and left by Uber, and there's text messages of her begging to come back, and Tristan wouldn't let her. So then her boyfriend calls the embassy and calls the police from France or whatever country she's from, and they instigate this high-level fucking police SWAT raid for kidnapping, and they come into my house, sorry, Tate, sorry, we're sorry, it's from the embassy. Because if it was actually Romanian stuff, the police wouldn't even come. If the Romanian called the Romanian police, they'd be like, we ain't going to the top G's house. He ain't kidnapping bitches. He's kicking them out. No way. They know me. But because it's from an embassy, because the French embassy, blah, blah, international incident, blah, blah, blah. So the police come here, had to take all my things. This is 2 days after the event. I'm about to get all my electronics back already. Because they know I didn't fucking do anything. The girls broke down crying, admitting she made it up.
whoopies. Stupid whoopies.
So what's the lesson of the day? Lesson of the day is that the police treat me with respect because I treat them with respect. Listen, I may be a gangster and they may be the police, but if they're the top level police and I'm the top level G, we're friends. Just like the top level generals in war on enemy sides, they're still friends. So if the police are ever gonna rough you up, it's because you're a low level player. They come into my house with respect. No one put their hands on me. Do you know why no one put their hands on me, Luke? Because you can't touch that coat.
To play your own game, cover it up, don't let them know what you're thinking. I bet you never tell them how it feels, how it feels.
Come on, fire.
So my Instagram's blown up. I was at like 400K when I was underground, and then I've gone to 2.4 million in about 2 months. When I blew up on TikTok, everyone started following me, so I blown up on Instagram. And my Instagram is almost basically unusable now. I get 5,000 or 6,000 DMs an hour. I can't possibly read them. What's worst about it is that people have no fucking concept of how busy I am. If I go on my Instagram inbox, I am so ridiculously busy. And they'll message me things like, hey, how are you? Oh, I'm fine, bro, how are you? I don't have time for that. What do you want? Like, at least, your best shot, at least tell me what you fucking want, quick.
Hey bro, how are you? I just want to chat. Do you have time for a quick phone call? No, I do not have time to fucking call you because money has no value to me and time is exceptionally valuable to me. And the chance of you having a good idea is zero anyway. And even if your idea is good, all it's going to do is give me money, which I don't want, and take my time, which I do want. So the chance of me calling you, hey man, is 0%. Fat zero. But hey bro, or how are you? Even people I've known a long time, right? Now that I'm super famous, people who I've known a long time, who I actually like, people, no, I don't dislike these people, people I like, are messaging me. And I'm saying this with respect, get to the fucking point. Tate, I need this. Or Tate, can we do this? Don't be like, Tate, how you been? I know it's polite, I get that. I don't care about polite. I do not have time. I am low on time. I spend an hour and a half a day on Instagram. I gotta get through 5,000 messages. I won't spend more time on Instagram because it's bad for my mind. My brain is better used elsewhere. So I'm scanning through. I'm trying to pick out the pussy, the hot chicks. Just, yep, hottie, accept, hottie, accept, hottie, accept. Accepting all the hot girls and then all the dudes with the, what they want and shit. Get to the point. So my Instagram's basically fucked now because the inbox is fucked. Everyone's just messaging me fucking pure shit. It's fucked. But I made a Tate speech a while ago about how I had the best Instagram in the world. And I promised I'd read you all more poems. I'm kissing this bitch and remember your lips. I'm missing your touch while she's in this called battle scars, girl. I guess I finally got hit, but I'm a champion and I'm made for this shit. So I thought now's a good time to read some poems to you because I'm an emotional, soft, sensitive man. This is a picture of me in Paris at the Eiffel Tower. Now, Paris is the city of love, as we all know. There's no way I would ever call Paris a rotting cesspit covered in rats and crime and homeless. I don't know why anyone would say that about the city of love. Because it would be a shame. It would be an awful shame if a nation were to have a city, a capital city, which is renowned internationally for being associated with something as beautiful as love. And because they are so inept, they allow it to crumble before their very eyes. I mean, what type of people would even do that? Surely not, and especially not the ultra-competent French. Never in a million years would they let their city fall apart. I love Paris. So, I was in Paris for one day only, luckily. I managed to escape quite quickly. And I took a picture, and I decided to write a poem. And when I write these poems, I always worry. And my worry is that because everyone on Earth is so many miles below me, perhaps they don't get the timing right. Perhaps they read it, but in their tiny little brains, it doesn't sound the way it's supposed to sound because they're not as smart as I am. So perhaps the best thing I can do is just read it out loud to them like children so they can hear how it was always intended to exist. Here we are. Every time I leave, there's tears in her eyes. She knows how I'm earning, and she wants me alive. The struggle is finished, but I still only strive. Understand it's how life taught me to survive. Every time I'm moving, there's a strap, no doubt. I don't respect the law, so why travel without? It's rained and it's poured, I even built up a spout. The withouts want my buckets when they're living in drought. Every time that we fuck, I crush my soul into yours. We mix pain and insane with Eiffel Tower tours. I collect cash quiet behind double locked doors. Without profit to make, there wouldn't be wars. Money has no value, so I give you time with the dawn. You're in love with my brains, obsessed with my brawn. Enemies won't stop, now the guns have been drawn. I just hope you still love me after I'm gone. Top G. Now, I don't think numbers go high enough to explain the level of women who blew up my inbox when I posted that picture. Because they look at me and go, he's a savage. This guy, he's big and strong and rich, and he's a gangster, and he's living in Romania, and he's got all this money and all these women. Surely he's heartless. And then they read the poem and they go, maybe there's a glimmer of hope. Maybe I'll be the one he writes poems about. And 1,000 beautiful women inbox me. And then there's always some dork who comments under it, you write poems, you're gay. Like, all right, bro, I'm gay because all the chicks are messaging me. That makes me gay. Cool. So, and I don't just do it for the chicks. I do it because I can. And when you're at my level of competence, at my level of ability, you just do things because you can do them. But just for all the players out there who are wondering, The number one comment on that poem is Aiden Ross saying, please check your DMs. The little fat kid who I kind of somehow now like, who's a Twitch streamer. He's all right. He's fine. Let's find another poem. Let's find another one. I stopped writing poems for a while. There was no poems. I was given motivational quotes. But let's find another poem I've written. Where's the last time I wrote a poem? Me buying another Bugatti, my second one, the Bugatti with my new name, double gold caramel billionaire. Those ice creams are serious, by the way. I recommend you try them. Me with my Lambo, me on the private jet. Okay, here we go. Me in church. I'm a good man. Blah, blah, blah. Ferrari, Aston Martin DBS, private jet again, Porsche 911, private jet again. Me in McDonald's with the Bugatti, of course. We're gonna get there, don't worry. There must be a poem somewhere. I stopped writing for a while. Me in the police cell, Chiron again. So this poem is about how a man cheats on a woman, treats her like shit, and then she becomes a dickhead. And the man wants to hold her back, but now she's broken inside and she ain't loving anymore. That's why all my exes started messaging me. Did you write that about me?